Hi, I'm Kay Reichlin. I have the pleasure of introducing Steve Wax. Many of you heard him. Many of you heard him speak last year, and he is back again to tell us more, hopefully about the Innocence Project this time. Steve is an East Coaster originally, but he's become a real Oregonian. He was educated at Colgate University and Harvard Law School, and practiced in a prosecutorial office for about 4 years before he became the federal defender in Portland. And he did that for 31 years. Now he is the legal director of the Oregon Innocence Project. And I'm sure he'll tell us all about overzealous prosecution and sometimes persecution of people that are innocent.
Steve. Thank you, Kay. So is this mic working?
Yes.
Good, all right. Well, thank you very much for the invitation to come back. I enjoyed being with you all a year or so ago, and hope that you enjoy this return. If not, well, that's life, right? I am planning on giving you an update on some of the national security work that I have been doing and the work at the Innocence Project. And to get into it, I thought that I would start with a little bit of context. And the context will focus on the realities of the world in which we are living. I gave a similar talk to another similar group a few months ago, and that talk was shortly after the bombings and shootings in Paris and Beirut, and the harsh realities of the world that we are living in as reflected in those incidents, and a little bit of a discussion about the different reaction that we in America and probably the Europeans had to what happened in Paris as contrasted with what happened in Beirut. What do we care about? What focuses us? What type of people being hurt get us all exercised or increase our fear and concern? As I perceived it, America was really up in arms about the terrorist acts in Paris. I think more people died in Beirut. It happened in the same time frame in a major city, but in a city populated by different types of people, mainly people of a different religion, a disfavored religion in many places in the world these days, and people of a different color. And our focus, our concern, our hearts went out to the Parisians, to those nice, primarily white, primarily Christian people living in France. Well, the context today comes closer to home, because the context today, this talk about justice, injustice, and terrorism occurs while there are still four people holed up with rifles and other firearms in this great state. The talk today occurs on the very day that the United States Attorney unseals an indictment accusing 16 people of conspiring to impede federal agents in this great state of ours. And I think that as we ponder what is going on in our society, as we ponder the notions of justice and injustice and prosecution or persecution, and how one can and should react to injustices, that it is important to take a look at and to think about what's going on in the world and how we react to it differently. And I'm just going to throw out, with respect to Malheur and terrorism, a few questions. How do we feel, how should we feel as a society about a group of people who take up arms, who go online with statements about the need to be prepared to fight the federal government, who go into a federal park, wildlife refuge, take over federal property, destroy some federal property. And if you listened to some of the comments that were being made by some of the people who were there, you would have heard, for example, one of the people who was there saying, she's there because God was talking to her. She was there because it was consistent with her religious beliefs. She's there because her religion required her to talk to her husband, who in her household makes the decisions. Now, context. In this very same time frame, we are reading about nice, fine, young, primarily, perhaps Pakistani-born British citizens or American citizens who say that they are going to the Middle East because God has a mission for them, because there are people there in Syria, ISIS or ISIL, who they want to join the fight and take up arms. And I just ask, how do we react? Do we see a parallel? Is there a parallel? And how should that inform or not inform how we respond? I ask. The indictment that was unsealed today carries a charge with a 5-year maximum sentence. The people who were charged are primarily, or I guess exclusively, white, and they are primarily, if not exclusively, professed Christians. I just ask, is there a disparity that we should be thinking about when they are facing a 5-year maximum penalty for having firearms on a federal preserve, having a standoff with armed federal agents, destroying federal property, talking about the importance of taking back the land from the federal government? When the people who are Muslim and browner hued, who go online and talk about the importance of fighting with ISIL in Syria, get charged with crimes that may carry a 15-year maximum or a maximum penalty of life. As a society, I think that those are some things that we should at least think about and reflect upon. Well, within that context, and in thinking about prosecutions of people for terroristic type acts, one of the things that happens, as I have experienced it, is that we often will paint with too broad a brush, at least in some situations. At least what I've seen with people who practice Islam and are somewhat darker hued than most of the people in this room. Danger. We tend to, in painting with this too broad a brush, not pay, as I see it, sufficient attention to the importance of and the value of each of us as individual human beings. And that we sometimes will forget that we need to accord every human being value, worth, dignity as an individual. If you think about the things that are said, that were said in France quite recently, the things that were said in this country shortly after 2001, and that have been said by the guy who came in second place in the presidential campaign in Iowa. You know, think about that. You know, so people laugh. Now, I'm sure there are some nice Republicans in the room, and I'm sure that there are tremendous values that the Republican Party stands for. But just think about context and what we are saying as a society when a leading presidential candidate says, shut down all the mosques. painting with a broad brush. We don't like what happened in France. Kick out all the Syrians. Shut down all the mosques. Prohibit any Muslim from immigrating to this country. Now, if that's being said by a legitimate presidential contender, not a person who is just sitting on some, you know, blog, fulminating for, you know, himself and his two listeners, we should at least reflect upon what that says about the danger that inheres in our reaction, overreaction to acts of terror. The vice president of 15 years ago, who served as vice president for 8 years, vice president of this country, an adherent to what was then called the 1% doctrine, in terms of painting with too broad a brush, the 1% doctrine, meaning if there's a 1% chance that a person will harm this country, then it's okay to take action. Vice President Cheney. Now, I grew up and have practiced my entire career with the notion of, you know, a presumption of innocence and, you know, government has to prove something beyond a reasonable doubt. Well, that gets stood on its head, and we have seen it get stood on its head in the highest echelons of our government. In the French, you know, creating for, I think it was supposed to be 3 months, you know, what is a suspension of their civil liberties as a reaction to the attacks in France. Well, relative dangers and context. I had a fascinating experience about a month ago with a group of Pakistani terrorism judges. Judge Michael Mossman, who became chief judge of the district court here in Oregon on February 1st, sits on the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court of the U.S. of A. Some of you may have heard of it. I'm going to get into a description of that later. In shorthand, FISA, the FISC, is the secret court that has the power to authorize secret wiretaps in terrorism situations. So as a result of Judge Mossman's work, he has been overseas and he has interacted with judges who deal with terrorism in other countries. And so he invited a group of Pakistani terrorism judges to come to Oregon as part of a tour that they're on, put together by the State Department. What a fascinating experience to sit down with these men and one woman who spend their lives dealing with acts of terror in Pakistan. And in talking with them and the types of cases and the frequency of the cases that they experience, I found it very helpful to put into a slightly different perspective what we've experienced in this country and to question a little bit more this broad brush response to acts of terror and the way in which we vilify large segments of the population just because of who they are as opposed to whatever they've done. Now, you talk to judges who are sitting out there on the front line with the Taliban quite active in Pakistan and dealing with the daily acts of violence that they encounter. At least for me, it said, be thankful. We live in America yet again. And maybe things aren't quite as bad, and maybe we really shouldn't be quite as afraid as we sometimes are. Well, in thinking about this great country, and in thinking about the justice system, and in thinking about injustice. A couple of years ago, I had the opportunity to reflect on the parallels and lack of parallels between our justice system, what we are experiencing today, and what occurred in Germany from, well, starting in the 20s, but when Hitler took power in 33 through the end of World War II in 45. German Federal Bar Association put together an exhibit about law, lawyers, and judges in Germany during the Reich. And I was asked to give a presentation on that, and got me into it and reflecting a bit on law, the rule of law, and how that relates to some of the work that I do in this country. One of the things that was very interesting to take a look at was Nazi Germany was not a lawless society. Nazi Germany had rules, had statutes. Hitler didn't just say, let's go round up all the Jews and kill them or deport them. They passed statutes. They passed laws, the racial laws, a series of racial laws. And racial laws which, as the 30s went on, 33, 34, 36, 38, became more and more restrictive, setting up more and more legal barriers to Jews and communists and homosexuals and other disfavored people. You can't practice this profession. It was interesting to see that at first they pass a law that says Jews can't be lawyers. Okay, well, that's bad. Then they pass another law that no lawyer, Christian, that's all that's left, or a judge, Christian, that's all that's left, can cite a precedent if a Jew had uttered it. So let's, you know, rewrite history, and let's not just stop people from practicing a profession, but let's say, you know, that this disfavored population, you can't even rely on anything that any of them have said. So you have a rule of law, which got me to thinking, and Malheur gets me to thinking yet again about just and unjust laws. What of the protesters in Malheur? What of the criminals? What of the terrorists? Whatever they are, how do we want to define them? Part of what they've been saying is the federal government's ownership of land is unjust. Part of what they've been saying is we want to change the legal framework. So they are, in one sense, protesting. Now, my successor, Lisa Hay, representing one of the protesters, was quoted the other day as saying her client should be released because he was just exercising his First Amendment rights to protest the government. And I thought, go for it, Lisa. Way to go. That's exactly what I would have said. But I'm not representing the guy, so I don't have to say that anymore. And then I read what Judge Stacey Beckerman said back to Lisa. Yeah, she didn't say it in quite this tone and in quite these words, but she said, Lisa, come on. This isn't just a nice political peaceful protest on the sidewalk with a sign. These bozos are sitting out there with guns and threatening to shoot people. And she said, motion for release denied. But think about just and unjust laws. And what should we as a society do? And what's the obligation of a lawyer if you think the law is unjust? How far do you go to try to change the law, and in what ways? Well, one of the other things that reflected upon with respect to that is you have the Nuremberg trials. We're most of us, I assume, familiar with the fact that after World War II, we convene a system of trials and prosecute people. How many of the tens, hundreds of thousands of Nazis, of people who participated in the Holocaust, do you think were actually prosecuted? I think it was 187. You know, what a huge deal. Okay, they took some of the leaders, but there were tens of thousands of people who participated in what the world called war crimes, and they weren't prosecuted. All right, we made a statement as a world. Now think about Germany 1989. The wall comes down, the country reunifies. So one day in November, a guy sitting on the wall is getting an order from his president, if anyone tries to cross that border, that wall, shoot him. Legally justified act to kill somebody under the East German law. The wall comes down. The country unifies. Well, under West German law and under the unified German law, that homicide was no longer justified. What do you do? Well, the Germans actually prosecuted some people, and they didn't prosecute others. But it was a terribly difficult situation for them in terms of trying to figure out just law, unjust law, what do you do with it? Malheur. So I said a moment ago, think about it. These guys are charged. Well, it's a crime. You know, it carries a 5-year maximum penalty, which means probation's available. And many of them will probably not go to prison, although some may. Is that fair? Is that right? How does the politics, small p, how does it enter into the charging decision? How does it enter into the sentencing decision? How should it enter into our thoughts about what's going on out there? Is it a political protest? If it's a political protest, should we want these guys to spend as much time in prison as the Muslims who want to go and kill in Syria? Or not? Last point of context from Germany, which I will get back to when I start talking about some of my cases, is Article 48 of the Constitution of the Weimar Republic. Great constitution. Didn't protect them from Hitler. Article 48 says, in essence, that the head of the German government, if he thinks the circumstances justify it, can suspend all other laws. Okay? Called by people who've written about that, the doctrine of exception. Doctrine of exception to the laws. Well, I believe that I dealt with in this country, in some of my cases, George Bush, Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, exercising an American doctrine of exception with respect to some of my work in Guantanamo, where they said we put people in Guantanamo so that they would have no access to the law. The law, American law, doesn't apply there. They have no right to lawyers, no right to visits, no right to any court proceeding. Why? Because President Bush said publicly to us in the media, said in court papers through his Solicitor General to the U.S. Supreme Court, I am the Commander-in-Chief. And as Commander-in-Chief under our Constitution, I have the authority to say I can seize and imprison someone for as long as I believe necessary, and that person has no right to any process. Doctrine of exception. I'm the president. With respect to this group of people, no other law applies. Now, we litigated that, and I'll tell you about how we won or lost in a few moments. All right. So, I've been talking a bit about context and some abstract notions of justice and law. So let's get real. Let's bring it down, because these are not abstractions. In my career, I have and am dealing with all of those concepts, all of the notions of justice and access to law that I have just been talking about, and a few more. So, three tracks, really, on which I'm currently working. One is directly related to the continued representation of Mohammed, the young man who was convicted in what we call the FBI bombing plot what the government called his effort to blow up Pioneer Square on Thanksgiving Day, day after Thanksgiving, in the Christmas tree lighting ceremony in Portland in 2010. Second track is the book that I'm currently writing on one of the cases I tried here in Oregon, in Eugene. Iranian-born client, Muslim, who was accused of funding terrorism in Chechnya. And the third track involves the work that I'm doing at the Innocence Project. So let me talk first about Muhammad, because I think that some of the issues that we're addressing in that case relate most directly to some of the notions about Germany and the rule of law, secrecy, etc. I will only say things that are in the public record and that are in the appellate brief that we have filed. The appeal has not yet been heard by the Ninth Circuit. But among the issues that come up in that case, among the things to think about in terms of painting with a broad brush, access to justice, secrecy, classification, are these. The government proceeded in that case using the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act and the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court. Government said, we have obtained information and it is classified, and we'll make the decision about what we're going to show you. And they used what's called the Classified Information Procedures Act, which sets out the ways in which classified information gets disclosed in a courtroom if there is a trial or some sort of proceeding. The statute, which says if the government believes that something is classified and that its disclosure would harm the nation, the government can withhold that from a defendant, can show it to the court and say to the court, you can't show this to the defendant, and the court generally will say, okay, government, we agree with you. Now, the classification process is a very interesting animal. Classification process, I'll give you an example from my work in Guantanamo. Assistant Defender Pat Ehlers and I would sit down with a client. We would take notes. We would then have to give those notes to a government censor, to someone who worked as a legal person for the Department of Defense, who would get to decide whether what our clients had told us was classified and whether it was safe for us to have it and for it to be out in the public domain. Well, Pat's notes would go to one guy. My notes would go to another guy. They'd black out this and they'd black out that, and then we'd get the notes back. Guess what? Stuff in my notes is blacked out, but it's not blacked out in his. And stuff in his notes is blacked out, but it's not blacked out in mine. Muhammad's case. One of our issues on appeal has to do with what we call selective declassification. So the facts. Here are the facts. The government uses its electronic apparatus through the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act to obtain the content of Mr. Muhammad's text messages, emails, and phone calls. Okay? We don't have access to them, and of course he doesn't remember everyone he talked to and everything he said. But we know how many phone calls and text messages he made and the numbers, because for those of you who have cell phones, probably most people in the room, if you get a paper bill every month, it's like a telephone book. Every call, every text message that you make is listed, but without content. So we knew and we said, look, there were 12,000 calls and text messages in this, whatever, 12-month period. Government gives us 2,000. We said, yo, guys, come on. We know there are 12,000. He's a participant in all of them. we're able to determine who's on the other end. How on earth can it affect national security to withhold those other 10,000? Denied. Though we're saying to the appellate court, we think that was legally wrong. I think it's silly, but I don't think I'll say that in the brief. But that's part of what goes on here and part of what we're dealing with. National security, FISA classified information. In 1949-50, an airplane was being flown around by the Department of Defense. It crashed. The widows and orphans sued, and they said, "Government, we think you were negligent in your handling of that airplane." The United States government went into court and said, dismiss the case. If this case, this lawsuit, alleging negligence, is permitted to go forward, the nation will crumble. National security will be implicated, and you cannot allow this case to go forward at all. 1953, in a case called Reynolds versus the United States, Reynolds, one of the deceased, one of the widows, says, the Supreme Court says, case dismissed. That's right. You can't allow this lawsuit to proceed if there is a potential that it will disclose national security information. When I was reading about this case, I was surprised to learn that the Supreme Court said that without ever reviewing any of the classified information. Oh, okay, you're from the Department of Defense and Department of Justice, we'll trust you. 50 years went by, and most of our classification statutes say after 50 years, sometimes after 25, maybe sometimes after 75, open the books. 2003, maybe it was 2000, whatever the 50th year was, the books are opened. The remaining widows and remaining orphans take a look and go, this is being televised, I won't swear. They say something unpleasant about the people who had done the classification. It was negligence. The plane was not full of super high-tech electronic equipment, and it had nothing to do with that. Some bozo just did something wrong with, you know, one of the propellers and the plane went down. So they said, let's reopen the lawsuit, which I thought was entirely reasonable. Supreme Court said no. In this Reynolds case, which I cited in Muhammad and in Pete Sada's case I'll talk about in a minute, the Supreme Court had said, you know, there's a difference between our civil and our criminal justice systems. If you're dealing with a civil lawsuit, someone wants some money from the government because they say the government did something wrong. Well, you know, if the government says there's national security here, it's only money, okay. But the Supreme Court said criminal cases are different. The government wants to take away somebody's liberty or life in a death penalty case, then the rules have to be different, and you cannot deprive a defendant of the information he needs to defend himself. I read that language and I thought, well, guys, you got it right. And a few years later, in another case, they said the same thing, and in another case, they said the same thing. But then they also said, but you can give some substitutes for this classified information, or maybe a summary of it, if a judge thinks that it really is enough for a person to prepare his defense. Well, we said in Muhammad's case, and we said in Sada's case, you know, Reynolds, you got to give us this. But all of the other courts have said no. And I said, all right, guys, hang on a sec here. I have a security clearance. I needed to get one for my Guantanamo work. I also had to have a full-field FBI background investigation to get my job as federal defender, and then they renewed it some other time in one of the reappointment processes. I said, I have a security clearance. My security clearance is identical to that held by a prosecutor, an FBI agent, I sign the same contract against disclosure. I'm subject to the same laws if I do disclose. And while my security clearance was only at the secret level, it was upgradable as needed if there were top secret information, and some of my Guantanamo colleagues got top secret, and upgradable again to compartment C or compartment B, you know, some of the highfalutin classification language. It's identical. I said, hello, judge, give it to me. You know, I have this clearance. No, the law says that just because I'm a lawyer representing a guy the government wants to put in prison for the rest of his life, as in Muhammad's case, that's not enough reason. I said, okay, hang on. There are roughly 4.5 million Americans with security clearances. Many of them work for Bechtel or Black Hole and, you know, some of these other contractors. Some work for the Department of Defense. Some work for DOJ, et cetera, et cetera. I said, I'm a U.S. government employee. I'm an officer of the court. I'm a judiciary employee. You're going to tell me that you're going to trust some 25-year-old kid working as, you know, a functionary for a contractor, but you don't trust me? And the court said, that's right, Mr. Wax, we don't. You don't have a need to know. All right. I was not happy. Still not. So one of the other issues in Muhammad's case in terms of, you know, how we paint with a broad brush and how we treat people, involves the undercover operatives who interacted with Muhammad. If you followed the case in the media at all, what you heard was that for a four-month period, these undercover operatives were meeting with Muhammad and videotaping all of their meetings. Okay, we have the videotapes. We can see and hear what was being said. Gosh golly, you know, the very first meeting during which the question arose as to who introduced the subject of bombing in Portland. No, the recorder didn't work. Okay, so we said, well, under American legal system, some of you may have heard of the Confrontation Clause of the Sixth Amendment. We have a right to confront our accusers, okay? No secret proceedings, okay? Well, we have classified information, but no secret proceedings. So you have a right to confront your accusers. Well, that means you have a right to look a guy in the eye in the courtroom and question him about his background. Is he being truthful? And the Supreme Court has said, since it ever started writing about this subject, that the foundation of the ability to cross-examine is to know who your accuser is. Name, rank, serial number. Where do you work? What's your prior work experience? We weren't allowed to know who these undercover operatives were. They testified under pseudonyms, and we were given whitewashed resumes that said, you know, attended a college in the Midwest, born in a foreign country, worked in law enforcement for 8 years. We said, no, that's not right. That's not the American way. This first meeting where the tape recorder, gosh golly, failed, that's the critical meeting. This is where, you know, the rubber's going to meet the road in this case. Nope, sorry. So we're saying, you know, that was not, you know, proper to withhold that information from us. But in terms of Alice in Wonderland or Kafka in America or however you want to look at it, it gets worse. Because we're clever guys. We figured out who one of them was. And we said, we know who it is. And the court said, yet, you may not use that information because it's classified. Come on. We figured it out. We know. And I can't tell you anything more than that because I still have a security clearance obligation. All right. Pete Seda. Justice, fighting for justice, and work that is bears a fair relation to what I am doing with the Innocence Project. Pete Seda was born in Iran in 1958. His daddy was a colonel in the Shah's army. They lived a nice life. His daddy left, retired, and went into, it wasn't oil, but you know, vegetable oil business. And they lived a good life. But daddy saw the handwriting on the wall. And in the mid-70s, the boys all were sent overseas. And for reasons that I don't think Pete or anyone really knows, other than the fact that one of his older brothers really liked the sort of hippie lifestyle on the West Coast, ended up in Ashland, Oregon. Another brother ended up in Eugene, Oregon. And it certainly wasn't the desert that they were used to, and there weren't any of the restrictions that existed in Iran. And they had a good old time. Well, Pete, after exploring life, he started working in the forests. And he likes the forests, and he worked for the Forest Service. He made some good friends down in Ashland, and they lived out in an elk tent in Sprague River for a while, and explored religions, explored various aspects of American life that are available and that are today legal and probably weren't back then. He got himself an associate's degree from Southern Oregon University in silviculture and set up his own arborist business. Very successful and was making a good living. Wonderful, charismatic fellow and a quirky fellow who really fit in Ashland. He bought a camel because he started doing Muslim outreach and bringing in the high school kids to a tent. He bought a Saudi-style tent, put it on his property, and every week some other school would come and he'd talk about the Middle East and Islam. He set up a little foundation out of his own pocket to do dawah or Muslim outreach. And on the 4th of July, if you've never been in Ashland on the 4th of July, which I haven't, but I've seen pictures, I'm told, go. They have one of the quirkiest 4th of July parades in the US of A. Pete would ride his camel Mandoob. And some years when Mandoob wasn't feeling well, he had a pain in his hoof, Pete would drive one of his high loader arborist trucks and he'd be sitting up there in the bucket or he'd have someone in the bucket and be part of the life. Well, one of Pete's tree-hugging friends from his Sprague River days, David Rogers, when Pete started looking back into his religion, Islam, David got interested in it. David converted. David decided that he wanted to learn more about Islam and learn Arabic so he could read the Quran in Arabic. He moved to Saudi. David was a high school wrestling and football star. I mean, he was a good gun-toting all-American boy from Southern Oregon. And he ends up in the bloody desert in Saudi Arabia. He was also a great horseman. And he ends up training horses for the king of Saudi Arabia. Pretty cool. And along the way, he met a fellow named Salomon Al-Bouteh, who was the parks commissioner in Riyadh, the capital of Saudi Arabia. Probably one of the few tree huggers in Saudi, who recognizes a tree. And David and Soleiman hit it off. Well, David is talking to Soleiman about his buddy back in Ashland, Pete, and Pete's little charity doing outreach work. And Soleiman says, well, I spend a lot of time doing volunteer work for Al Haramain, a Saudi-based charity, which in the 1990s had branches in around 50 countries in the world, an annual budget of $70 to $80 million. And Soleiman says, well, Al Haramain could provide some funds for Pete. David says, that's cool. Soleiman and David come back, they introduce, and Pete ends up setting up, funded by this Saudi charity, Al Haramain Ashland, a branch of the charity in the US of A. A branch of the charity in Oregon, in Southern Oregon, in this quirky little town of Ashland. And the charity has a larger budget than his old charity. A backdrop to what's happening in the 1990s were the Russian Chechen wars. I mean, part of what I love about being a lawyer is all of the incredibly diverse things that I had the opportunity to learn about that I knew nothing about. Chechnya? Yeah, it's some little country over there. You know, isn't that where they grow yogurt and, you know, used to be ads on TV, these guys 1,000 years old? No, that was, you know, that's Georgia. That's the Caucasus Mountains in Georgia. Well, Chechnya is another little republic over there in the Caucasus. I've learned it's the size of New Jersey. It's about 1.2 million people, primarily Muslim. And ever since the 1700s, the Chechens have been fighting the Russians. They didn't like the Tsars. Come the Bolshevik Revolution, the Chechens say, by God, we're now independent. The Bolsheviks said, no, you're not. They fought again. World War II, Stalin gets quite distressed about what's going on in some of his Muslim republics, and half of the Chechen population is removed to Kazakhstan to get them away from any of the potential fighting with the Germans so they can throw off the Soviet yoke. 1990, the Soviet Empire collapses, and many of the underbelly Islamic republics decide, we want freedom. Chechens say, here's our shot. Again, they don't give up. 1994-5, a god-awful war. The Russians leveled the capital, Grozny. Eventually, it stalemates, and there is a peace accord which holds until around 1999, when Putin decides that it's time to reinvade and reincorporate, and they level Grozny again. Pictures that I saw of that city were indistinguishable from pictures of Berlin 1945, when the Allied forces moved in. It was leveled. Well, the Muslim world was quite upset about what was happening to the primarily Muslim population in Chechnya, and Al Haramain, among other charities, started fundraising. Pete fundraises. A doctor philanthropist in Egypt sends some money through Pete's bank account in Ashland, all open and above board, that he believes is going to be humanitarian aid in Chechnya. Well, unfortunately for Pete, Al Haramain was on the U.S. terrorist watch list and radar because, as it has turned out, some of the branches of Al Haramain were funding terrorists in a number of places in the world. Some of the money was being diverted. Perhaps the Saudi government, which was sort of partially in control of Al Haramain, had something to do with it, our great ally. In Pete's case, one of the things that we tried to introduce in evidence, Judge Hogan said, no, you can't, was a picture of President Bush kissing the king of Saudi Arabia. You know, we said, look, you know, the Saudis and Americans were friends. You know, Pete was just helping our friends. Look, Bush kissing the king. Come on, that's relevant. The judge said, no. He was right. Well, Pete gets indicted in 2005. After a four-year investigation by the government into his background and what he was doing, the only thing that they could find was a mistake on one of his Al Haramain Ashland's tax returns for the tax year 2000, an $80,000 mistake. And he got indicted for it. But the indictments laid out in, you know, whatever, 6, 8, 10 pages, this whole scheme of terrorism, alleging that Pete had intentionally made this mistake on the tax return to hide the fact that he took this donation from the Egyptian philanthropist and sent it to Chechnya to fund the Mujahideen. So we get into the case. He says, no way, no how. And we start the fight. I'm writing a book about that trial right now, that case, and I'm going to read you an excerpt from it, brief, short, because I think I said it as well in writing as I could say it here. This is how I met the client. The deputy sheriff opened the windowless door to visiting room number 2 in the Lane County Jail in Eugene, Oregon. I was eager and curious to meet my new client. I stepped in and the metal door clanged shut. Set away from the dorms and cells, there was no sound as I strode into the grayish green space. The prisoner behind the small metal table at the back of the cell eyed me searchingly, then stood up and took a step to his left, brushing the concrete wall of the narrow cell with his shoulder. It was there on September 4, 2007 that I met Pete Seda, my new client accused by the United States Attorney of funding Muslim terrorists in Chechnya, the man with whom I would stand for much of the next 7 years of my life. Olive-skinned, dark-haired, and with a full but short black beard, the drab jail khakis made the 5'8" and well-muscled 175-pound Pete look small. Pete was 49 years old. While his handshake was firm as we said our first hello, his dark brown eyes were sad and his voice was flat. The nearly 3 weeks Pete had spent in the jail before I met him had clearly taken a toll on this proud man who had never before been locked in a cage with uniformed guards controlling his every move. As we paint with the broad brush, we sometimes sweep in innocent people who are real human beings, as are we in this room. Now, in representing Pete, we got into the Classified Information Procedures Act. We knew that the government had classified information on Pete, in part because we had come into possession of some classified information. And I can't tell you what it is, because not only is that prohibited by the security clearance, but it's also prohibited because the judge entered a gag order that prevented me from not only ever talking about it publicly, what I knew and what I believe would help my client, but he prohibited me from filing a court pleading about it. He prohibited me from talking to my client. He prohibited me from talking to my co-counsel about that information. I believed that there was far more classified information because in the course of representing Pete, we were able to hire the head, and I mean the head, of the United States Department of Defense Human Intelligence Section. DOD has in its intelligence unit two tracks, human intelligence, spies on the ground, running around, agents, secret agents, etc., and then the signals intelligence, all of the FISA intercept type of stuff. Well, Colonel Walter Patrick Lang was the head in 1992 to 94 of human intelligence. Colonel Lang had, previous to that, served as a top fellow in counterterrorism in the Department of Defense at the level where during Reagan, President Reagan's administration, Pat would be one of the guys who would go down into the basement of the White House in the morning, Ronnie there with his cup of coffee, saying, "Hey guys, did the world blow up last night anywhere I should know about?" And Colonel Lang is one of those guys who would say, "No, Mr. President," or, "Yes, Mr. President, you need to be aware of this hotspot." During the first Gulf War, Colonel Lang was one of the people who had regular interaction with President Bush about what was going on. Colonel Lang was a true patriot. Colonel Lang is one of the few people who had risen to that level in the government who was willing to talk with people on my side, my Defense Department. Defense of criminals, or accused criminals, or wrongly accused criminals. Before Pat would get into a case, Pat would vet the person. And it was only after some vetting spy to spy, however those guys do it with their security clearances, I don't know. He agreed to work with us. And he knew, through some of the contacts he made with some of the top-level government officials in Saudi Arabia, that there was stuff out there that would have helped us establish that Pete did not send any money to fund Mujahideen in Chechnya. We couldn't get at it because the court wouldn't give it to us. Eventually, the court required the government to produce some information for its review, and he wouldn't give it to us. Well, we go through this knockdown, drag-out, nasty, unpleasant trial, and Pete gets convicted. Government asks for a terrorism enhancement to give him the maximum sentence, which under a tax statute was only 8 years of that man's life. And in that sentencing process, we had one of the most bizarre experiences that I've ever had in a courtroom. We had testimony from former KGB agents, current FSB agents, sitting in the Lubyanka, the notorious prison area in Moscow, testifying via a live video feed into the courtroom in Eugene. Colonel Ignachenko. And sitting next to Ignachenko was another guy, Fedotov. And so Ignachenko starts to testify, and Fedotov leans over and whispers, "Objection, Your Honor. Who's that other man?" Just move on. "He did it again, Your Honor." "Oh, just move on." Finally, what is going on? Finally, we get the acknowledgement. "Oh, Fedotov is there because he works, so, you know, sorry, the political section? He's the handler. Got to make sure Ignachenko, Iggy doesn't say anything the Russian government doesn't want known." Ignachenko testifies that he knows that there was a conversation between a guy in Al Haramain and a guy in Chechnya about Al Haramain giving $50 million. My client's accused of $80,000, $150,000, $50 million to fund the Chechen Mujahideen. "How do you know that, Iggy?" "It's on a tape." "Where's the tape?" "Oh, we destroyed it." "Iggy, you serious?" "Colonel Lang has told us, and Colonel Lang knows because he's dealt with this at the highest levels. He's cooperated with the Russians. No spy agency worth its salt would ever destroy a tape of a conversation between a top-level terrorist and a top-level Saudi about sending $50 million to help blow up your own country." But that's Iggy's testimony. Judge Hogan even didn't buy that. Denied the terrorism enhancement. But he doesn't impose sentence right away. Instead, he has to ponder it. And about 3 weeks later, I get a call from the assistant U.S. attorney. "You know, Steve, there's something I got to tell you." "Oh, what's that, Chris?" "Well, the FBI paid one of its witnesses $15,000. Whoops, we should have told you we didn't. The boss has just ordered me to tell you. We brought it to the boss's attention when the FBI came in and said they wanted to pay her an additional $7,500. Now, if I paid a witness, it's bribery. If the government pays a witness, it's legitimate, it's okay, she's been traumatized, et cetera, et cetera. The witness they paid is the only witness in the entire case who provided any potential direct link between Pete and funding the Mujahideen. Said that after they were all on a Hajj in Saudi, at the end of the Hajj, Pete had said, "You know, we had to give the Saudis $200 sort of security money, and they've given it back because we didn't, you know, write any graffiti on any of their walls or whatever it was." And, you know, she said that Pete said, "Well, I'll send this money to the Chechen Mujahideen. Why don't you give it to me?" Conversation he adamantly denied. No one else present came in, you know, said it happened. And that's the witness who was paid. I'll wrap up on Pete, and then we can take a break. So Pete's case, we send it up on appeal. And on the appeal, while he has served his sentence, while he was still serving his sentence, we argue it. I say to the Ninth Circuit, there's this classified information out there that we should have had. We know it. Of course, I don't know what it is because I can't tell you. I can't tell you what I had that was important, and I can't tell you what the other court had because they won't let me see it. And the judges say to me, "Yes, okay, trust us." Well, thank God that the presiding judge on that panel of three, Judge Margaret McCune, had handled cases involving the same material in civil cases. Or possibly it's the same material, since I've never seen it. How do I know? But you read the opinions, and it seems like it may have been the same material. And in one of the appellate arguments in that case, she had said, "I feel like I am in Alice in Wonderland." Quote, direct quote from a Ninth Circuit judge. So she reads this stuff, and among the reasons why they throw out the conviction, she says, "The government distorted the summary that they gave us, and there was other information that would have been helpful to us that they withheld." And she said, "You can't pay a witness $15,000 and not tell the defendant that. So, guys, shouldn't have done that." And then there was another more traditional search and seizure issue. She said that they had violated the Constitution there as well. So the conviction gets thrown out, and after about 11 months, the U.S. attorney agreed and dismissed the indictment against Pete. The charity Al Haramain agreed that it would acknowledge it made a mistake on the tax return, and the government agreed that that mistake would not in any written document have anything to do with terrorism. So we fought. We fought for justice, we fought for Pete, we fought for a human being, we fought for a fair process, and that case had a very happy ending in some respects because Pete was vindicated. It has an unhappy side to it. He served the whole bloody sentence that the judges imposed before we won. And the poor guy, after 7 years, had to start picking up the pieces of his life, all of his arborist equipment and stuff, sitting there rusting that hadn't been sold along the way. And he is putting together now a construction business in Portland. He's, as I said, a very talented and energetic man, but it is not easy. So, we can take a break, leave this aspect of terror, and when you come back, I will talk about seeking justice with the Innocence Project, and then I will make sure I save you some time to show you a couple little movies. I know everyone likes movies. So, we are going to move away from terrorism for a few minutes and talk about the Oregon Innocence Project and the work of the Oregon Innocence Project and how it relates to what I've just been talking about with Mr. Seda, Mr. Muhammad, intelligence, classified stuff, etc. Our legal system provides people a right of appeal. If you are tried and convicted and you think that the judge made legal errors, you get to go to a higher authority, a court of appeals or a Supreme Court, and say, "Yo, dudes, my trial judge screwed me. Throw out the conviction. Let's try again." If you lose a direct appeal, you're entitled to what's called a collateral attack. Collateral, to the side, okay? And a collateral attack deals with things outside the record. So if you've been in a court, you see that there are stenographers, or these days it's tape recorders, taking down everything that's said. And all of the motions that are made are in paper form, and they're stuffed in a file in the courthouse. Collateral attack deals with stuff that's not on the record. Collateral attacks generally involve people saying, "My lawyer was ineffective. My lawyer did not investigate my alibi. My lawyer did not effectively cross-examine my accuser. The prosecutor engaged in misconduct. The prosecutor had evidence, like paying a witness $15,000, and the prosecutor neglected to tell me about it. And his boss didn't make him, as happened in Seda's case. Or the judge was biased. Or the jurors brought extraneous information into the jury room." Collateral attack. You do that through the state system. If you've been convicted in the state court, then you go to the Court of Appeals in the state Supreme Court. And if you've still lost, you then get to go to federal court and try again in the federal court and say to the federal judge, "Judge, my federal constitutional rights were violated when the prosecutor withheld evidence, my lawyer was ineffective, etc." And if you still can't get anyone to believe that you were unjustly convicted and that you shouldn't be in prison, you get to go to the governor of your state and say, "Governor, either pardon me, you know, yeah, I did it, but pardon me, or commute my sentence, yes, I did it, but the sentence is too long, or in some other way, give me clemency." So there are a variety of ways that a person who's been convicted can say, "Help." The Innocence Project comes into a case after a person has been convicted, been sentenced, and we can get in at any one of these stages after the conviction. We will generally only look at a case after the direct appeals are done. Maybe the person is in the post-conviction process, maybe later on. Reality in this country is that wrongful convictions, not just convictions where there is legal error, but wrongful convictions where a guy didn't do it, he was innocent, they exist. And that started to become known in the general, you know, media world through the work of the Innocence Project when it was set up by professors Barry Scheck and Peter Neufeld, lawyers and professors, Cardozo Law School in New York City back in the early 1990s. And they started doing work with DNA. And as the technology for DNA advanced, we were able to determine that a rape case where a victim came in and said, "That's the guy." The guy said, "I didn't do it. And there are no other witnesses." Well, now, if the rape kit was taken and it still existed, you could test it. You could see, is the DNA that was collected from the victim the DNA of the guy who was convicted? And if not, you get an exoneration. That started happening. Murder cases. DNA is left on murder scenes. Rape murder cases. There have now been in excess of 1,500 exonerations since the innocence movement, I'll call it, began in the early 90s. Roughly 400 involving DNA, meaning that there are other causes of wrongful conviction, and there are other ways to undo a wrongful conviction. So the Innocence Project takes a look at a number of things, a number of sort of standard causes of wrongful conviction. What can go wrong in these cases? Well, I've said ineffective assistance of counsel, lawyers who don't do their job, don't investigate what their clients tell them to investigate, lawyers who shouldn't be in the courtroom, lawyers who sleep through cases, it happens. Lawyers who are drunk and try cases, it happens. Misidentification is an unfortunate reality. And we're fortunate here in Oregon that Professor Dan Riesberg at Reed is one of the national leaders in understanding human memory and drawing the relation between the way in which memory functions and identification. And a couple of years ago, Dan Riesberg's work was relied on by the Oregon Supreme Court when it rewrote the law of admissibility of identification testimony. False confessions. Many of you, I'm sure, have read about the Central Park Five, I think it was, group of five young men, all young black men, accused of and confessed to raping a woman, is horrible, brutal attack in Central Park, New York. False confessions. DNA exonerated them. It happens. It's real. Prosecutorial misconduct, withholding evidence. And then there is this whole world of forensic science, junk science. What is real science? What's not real? what have we made assumptions about, including fingerprinting. My client, Brandon Mayfield, taken into custody on a material witness warrant, said to have been his fingerprints found in Madrid, Spain, on a bag of unexploded detonators. Brandon Mayfield, nice, white, Muslim convert, Portland lawyer, misidentification by the FBI. An affidavit filed by the FBI that said three senior examiners, each with 30 years experience, have declared a 100% match between Brandon's fingerprints and the fingerprints on this bag. And they were 100% wrong. Last spring, a little over a year ago, the FBI, having worked for several years in conjunction with the National Innocence Project people, gave notice of up to 3,000 cases in which FBI agents gave what they called inappropriate testimony about hair analysis. 5 cases in Oregon affected. Now, that doesn't mean that 5 innocent people were convicted, but it means that FBI examiners were going into courtrooms saying, this is a match. This hair found in the ski mask that was worn by the robber, rapist, what have you, matches the hair on the head of the defendant. And the FBI had to acknowledge, you can't say that. And that what their agents was saying was plainly and simply wrong. The Oregon State Police a few years ago disbanded its handwriting analysis unit, recognizing that handwriting analysis really ain't a science. So there are a number of causes of wrongful convictions, and those are some of them. So the Innocence Project, in terms of misidentification, we put on a joint program last year with the Oregon State Police at their police academy, at which the featured speaker was a woman named Jennifer Thompson, who gave an incredibly, incredibly emotional talk. I can't believe she does this around the country all the time, about her experience as a rape victim in the mid-1980s when she was a 22-year-old college student, where she went into court and testified, I am 100% certain that's the man. I will never forget his face. 2 years later, the conviction is thrown out for a number of reasons, and along the way, some guy has alleged to have confessed in prison. So the DA brings that guy into the courtroom, and the man who has been convicted, a man named Cotton, is there. And Jennifer Thompson again looks at Cotton and says, that's the man. It's not this other fellow you've brought in. But Cotton had been in prison for 11 years. They finally did DNA testing, and guess what? It was that other guy. Now, Jennifer Thompson is an amazing human being who has now dedicated her life to working with victims of crime, and she includes within her definition of victims of crime the wrongly convicted. He and Mr. Cotton have written a book together called Pickin' Cotton. Yeah, the serendipity of names. Misidentification. I represented a young woman named Lisa Roberts, who actually pled guilty to the murder as a manslaughter of her lover. After 2 years of preparing for trial, she pled guilty when her lawyer went into her the week before the trial is supposed to begin and said that he had newly discovered evidence provided to him by the prosecutor. Prosecutor says that he has an expert in cell telephone tower location, and they can now pinpoint her as having been in Kelly Point Park in Portland, where the body of her lover had been found. Lisa pled guilty. And then she said to herself very shortly after, look, I didn't do it. I can't stand this. And yes, I avoided a life sentence for a 15-year prison sentence, but I didn't do it. She went through the state system and nothing happened. She gets to the federal court into federal habeas corpus. Collateral attack, the last resort, federal system. My former office is assigned to represent her. Allison Tex Clark as the assistant defender assigned, Maya Godet, the investigator. They go meet with Lisa at Coffee Creek Prison, and Lisa says, I didn't do it. And Tex come to me, and Maya comes to me, and they say, this is different, Steve, we believe her. 4 years of effort. We finally got Judge Malcolm Marsh in Portland, who's from Salem originally, to order some DNA testing. Well, there had been DNA testing done at the time of the crime under an older technology. With the new advance in technology, the DNA testing enables us to know that under the victim's fingernails and in her vagina is the DNA of a fellow currently serving a sentence for a rape conviction. And we go and find some of the other women he had associated with, and we learn that this fellow liked to strangle women during the course of the sex act. And the victim, in our case, was strangled to death. We also get some real experts in cell telephone technology who tell us, no way, no how can you pinpoint the location of my client in Kelly Point Park based on the cell tower pinging that existed in that case. And we said to Judge Marsh, Judge Marsh, we know that under the law and procedure of federal habeas corpus, we have no right to be in your courtroom because she's defaulted it because the post-conviction lawyers didn't do their jobs and the trial lawyer didn't do their jobs. But Judge, there's an escape hatch. And the escape hatch is if we give you enough evidence of innocence, you can hear the claim. And we've got enough evidence of innocence, Judge. This DNA and this guy sitting out there sure as heck looks like he did it, not our client. And now, once we are through the gateway, into the courthouse, through the door with this evidence of innocence, Judge, we've got a substantive constitutional claim. Her lawyer was ineffective in the way in which he handled this cell tower bogus junk science nonsense of pinpointing. And here are the real experts telling you it can't. And Judge Marsh writes an 81-page opinion saying, habeas writ granted. Now we go back to the DA, and we say to the DA, dismiss the case and go indict this other guy. And the DA thinks about it, and the DA thinks about it, and the DA says, I will agree to dismiss the indictment, but I'm not convinced she's innocent. Well, May 28th of last year, while Texas gallivanting around Europe, I stepped into the case. She took an extended leave, and personally, I'm, it was awful. She goes off on this leave, and I say, sure, I'll babysit the case. We didn't think anything was going to happen, and then all this DNA stuff breaks, and I got involved in it because she wasn't here, and just ran with it, for about 6 months. She wasn't around. I went down to the Coffee Creek Prison, and I signed Lisa out. That was the first time in my career that it ever really just worked out that way. And what an incredibly powerful experience that was. To have this woman who had served 11 years, 9 months in prison for a crime she didn't commit walk out the prison gate. She gets into the car, and I say, hey, Lisa, you want to call your daughter? Sure. And I take this out of my pocket, and I hand it to her, and she says, what's this? Cell phone, iPhones didn't exist when she went into prison. Now, she'd had a flip, little old-fashioned flip phone. What's that? That's Innocence Project type of work. We are currently working on a case involving a fellow on death row where there is a lot of forensic material that was gathered from the crime scene that either was not tested or was not, the test results were not followed through on. We are currently working with another fellow who was convicted of a homicide where we are going back through in painstaking detail, looking at every single piece of paper, thousands of sheets of paper, and you read through them. It's not all glory. In fact, most of it isn't glory. It's just this seat of the pants, sit there, and you look, and you look, and you look, and you see finally, suddenly, something jumps out at you. And in that particular case, one of the things that jumped out at us was a police report where you have the report incident year 2000, let's say, and then you see there's a date on it, which you know isn't a typo because it repeats with a stamp as well as the typing of 2001. Where's the original report? Or where are the notes from the officer who wrote on that? And I don't want to go into any of the detail on it, but it's relevant. And you can't find that unless you look at every single piece of paper. And how on earth do you look at every single piece of paper? A cadre of students. I'm working half time. I'm semi-retired. I get to come down here and I enjoy myself. I don't know if you're enjoying yourselves, but I have fun. And we've got students who are in a clinic through Lewis and Clark. We have 7 students working with us right now. In the summer, we'll have between 8 and 10. We'll have some from Willamette, from the U of O, from Lewis and Clark, UW. We may even have some idiots from Harvard. I've got a retired ATF agent. Guy spent his career busting the bad guys, working for the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, working with us half-time for free. 2 civil lawyers who got tired of shuffling other people's money, volunteering with us. That's what the Innocence Project is about. And my boss, and I love it, I got a boss. 67 years old, and my boss is 36 or 37. It's terrific. Because I haven't had a boss in 36 or 37 years because I was the head guy. I got a boss, it's great. And so my boss would be unhappy with me if I didn't say, and oh, by the way, if you would like to contribute, the Oregon Innocence Project is a 501c3 tax-exempt organization, and we exist solely on donations. And I am actually even authorized to receive checks from people, and then he'll then send you a receipt. And if you don't want to do it that way, go to our website. All right, pitch over. So the Innocence work is incredibly painful because you're dealing with people in prison. It's also incredibly frustrating because the unfortunate reality is that most of what we're doing is separating the wheat from the chaff. In my experience as a criminal defense attorney, I learned very early on that I could not accept at face value the accounts provided to me by my clients. They were not always consistent with reality. And the reality that they perceived would also often shift over time. Regrettably, the same thing is true with the people who ask for our assistance. Not all of them are in touch with the reality of what they've done. It's also true that in many instances, I will never know what happened. The largest single category of cases on which we're getting requests for help are sex abuse cases, where a young woman, whether she was 4 or 7 or 14, is alleging the boyfriend, the father, the stepdad, the grandfather abused her in some way. And those cases have rarely any physical evidence. Rarely are there any eyewitnesses. They're almost overwhelmingly, he said, she said, or he said, cases. How on earth do you sort that out? You can't know. And if I can't know and can't do anything, we have to tell our inquirers, sorry, we can't help you. Or in this scheme of how you appeal and post-conviction and go to the governor, there's often no legal avenue open. And we have to tell the people that. Of the 200 plus inquiries that we've received for help, we've probably already told 50 people, and it's just a year and a half, sorry, we can't help you. And we have said to, maybe a half a dozen people, we have been devoting energy when, as I define it, you pick up a stone. You picture a row of rocks out here, you lift up a stone, you look under it, and you see, hey, is there any evidence of innocence? Or is there any overwhelming innocence of guilt? Looks pretty guilty. You put the stone down. Sorry, fella. You look at it. Hey, that's interesting. You pick up the next stone. Wow, maybe. You go to the next stone. Oh, sorry, fella. Can't tell. And you start. You pick up the stones. You look, and you see. Is there anything there? And is there anything that we can do? And that's not easy. And part of my job is to help keep the students enthusiastic and encouraged and engaged as they are going through that difficult process. And we need it. Have any of you read about the scandal at the Oregon State Police Crime Laboratory? No. There has been media coverage about a scandal at the Oregon State Police Crime Laboratory. Go home tonight, type in Google, Oregon State Police Crime Laboratory scandal, and you will find reports. There is an investigation ongoing with respect to one criminalist there who is likely to be indicted for stealing and probably falsifying drug testing records. There is another person who was sort of moved on, and when he was then hired by an unknowing defense attorney to testify in a case on behalf of the defendant, the prosecutor gets up and starts cross-examining the guy about how he was disciplined and chastised for his misstatements and bad work when he was working for the crime lab. Why didn't they ever disclose that? Who knows? But they did when they were cross-examining him. So you got that going. And there are a number of other issues brewing with respect to the crime lab. The governor has convened a task force to look into it, and the legislature may hold some hearings at some point, maybe at the end of this mini session or maybe in the interim. So there's a lot of work going on, and we've got a science project looking into that. All right, I'm going to end, as I said, with a couple of movies, and I better get to them so you have time for questions. The movies will take us back to terror, but terror with respect to Innocence Project type work. And that's my representation of some of the detainees and my office's representation of some of the men, I call them detainees, prisoners, bloody prisoners in Guantanamo. Federal Defender Office represented six people. All six of them are now home, perhaps in part due to our work, perhaps not. We conducted investigation on behalf of these men in Afghanistan, in the war zone, in Pakistan, in Sudan, and in the UAE. And what I want to show you are a couple of videos that we put together that we sent to the courts and to the military, showing them what we did. Innocence Project work, Guantanamo work, involves sometimes really difficult field investigation.
My name is Martin Caballero. I'm an investigator with the Federal Defender's Office, and I'm working on the Narzar Gul habeas case. I recently returned from Afghanistan and Pakistan, where we interviewed witnesses and obtained sworn video statements in Mr. Narzar Gul's case, a case in which an innocent, peaceful man is challenging his now 3.5 years of detention in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. This video provides a brief overview of the large amount of evidence of innocence we have documented in this case and which is being provided to the court in its entirety as exhibits to the current motion for summary judgment. Narzar Gul was born in Afghanistan. At the age of 3, he fled Afghanistan with his family when their village was bombed by the invading communist Russians. During the bombing, Mr. Gul lost the use of his right eye and other family members were killed. Leaving Afghanistan, the family made the torturous trip through the mountains seeking safety from the Russians in Pakistan. They became refugees in the small village of Duaba, Pakistan, where the family lived in exile for 25 years. In Duaba, they ran a small bakery and sold vegetables in the village market. Mr. Gul spent his days helping his brother Wazir in the family bakery. Growing up in Duaba, he was given the nickname Chaman by his friends because he loved to spend time in Chaman Park. After September 11th, the United States invaded Afghanistan and removed the oppressive Taliban government. Hamid Karzai, an ethnic Pashtun, just like Mr. Gul, was named as interim leader in December 2001. The removal of the Taliban and establishment of Mr. Karzai's government brought the Afghan people hope for peace after 20 years of occupation and civil war. Many exiles living in refugee camps and villages in Pakistan began to make plans to return to their home country. In April 2003, Mr. Gul, accompanied by three friends, Bakhtaji, Babrak, and Saifula, decided to return to Afghanistan to look for work and re-establish their life in their home country. The four men went to Gardiz, Afghanistan, where Bakhtaji knew a man named Mohammed Akhtiar. Mr. Gul did not know Mr. Akhtiar until he arrived in Gardiz in spring 2003. Mohammed Akhtiar allowed the travelers to stay in his home when they first arrived in Gardiz. He also told them of possible jobs working for the Karzai government. Mr. Akhtiar introduced the four men to another man named Ulos. Ulos worked for the Karzai government as a supervisor guarding a fuel depot. Ulos hired all four men to guard the fuel depot. They were assigned to a single post outside of Gardiz. In April 2003, after the men had worked at the jobs for a couple of weeks, Mr. Gul began suffering from an infected molar. The oral infection spread quickly, and witnesses described Mr. Gul's appearance as marked by a swollen face. Mr. Gul asked his supervisor if he could leave work to seek medical attention in Gardiz. Ulos gave Mr. Gul permission to travel to Gardiz and asked his co-worker, Saifula, to accompany him. Nazar Gul and Saifula were walking towards Gardiz when they were met by taxi driver Dawajan. Dawajan offered to drive Mr. Gul to see a pharmacist. Dawajan then drove Mr. Gul into Gardiz and accompanied him to see a pharmacist named Itzaula. Itzaula specifically recalls seeing Mr. Gul about his tooth in 2003. Because the swelling was extreme, Itzaula could not assess the seriousness of the infection. He gave Mr. Gul medication and told him to return when the swelling subsided. Because he needed to return to see the pharmacist for further treatment, Mr. Gul remained in Gardiz for the night. Dawajan drove Mr. Gul to the home of Mohammed Akhtiar, the person who had given him and his friends a place to stay when they first arrived in Gardiz. Mr. Gul spent the night at Mr. Akhtiar's home. Later that night, Mr. Gul was awakened by the sounds of gunfire. American military personnel burst down the doors of Mr. Mohammed Akhtiar's home and arrested both Mr. Gul and Mr. Akhtiar. All of these documented events occurred within just weeks of Mr. Gul arriving back in his home country for the first time in 25 years. Our investigation, both at home and abroad, in Afghanistan and Pakistan, has confirmed these events leading up to the arrest of Mr. Gul. Our investigation has also concluded that Mr. Gul was most likely arrested in a case of mistaken identity. When Mr. Gul identified himself by his nickname, Chaman, he was mistaken for a man with the same name. That man, Commander Chaman Gul, was a former Mujahideen fighter who lived in Afghanistan. The military's mistaken belief as to Mr. Gul's identity is made clear by the review of the accusations made in Mr. Gul's CSRT proceedings. Initially, he was accused of being a long-standing fighter and commander in Afghanistan. Later, the military apparently discovered its error. In its subsequent ARB proceeding, they dropped the accusation that Mr. Gul was a military commander. The evidence we have obtained provides incontrovertible proof of Mr. Gul's innocence. The evidence proves the background of Mr. Gul, his employment at the fuel depot for the Karzai government, the reason for his presence at the home of Mohammed Akhtar, and the very short period of time he was ever in Afghanistan. 3.5 years have now passed with Mr. Gul detained without charges. 3.5 years have passed without access to evidence that supposedly exists against Mr. Gul, but which has yet to be presented by the government. 3.5 years have passed without a process for Mr. Gul to challenge his detention. Mr. Gul has lost 3.5 years of life, time spent in a small cell away from his family. Justice requires he be released immediately.
Mr. Gul went home in February of 2007. And he had one request of us. He didn't want a settlement from the government. He just wanted back pay in Afghan dollars for what at that point was about 4 years of imprisonment. He said, look, all right, you know, you guys made a mistake, fine. Just give me the money that I would have earned. And of course, the answer was no. And he had no right of access to any American court to file a civil suit. Now, I've got two other short videos about one of our other clients. We've got about 15 minutes left, so your choice. You want to ask some questions or do you want to see another movie? Oh, man. I hear a request for both. I'm going to show several minutes of a movie because how many of you watched The West Wing? All right. President Bartlet. You like him? All right. We're going to show you President Bartlet waiting for justice. The top one. This is our second movie on Mr. Hamad.
Hello, I'm Martin Sheen. We Americans must not allow fear to overcome our faith in the laws and values that have made this country great, like the right to a fair hearing in a court of law, like the right to know and respond to the charges against you, like the right not to be detained indefinitely, even by order of the president. All of these rights are protected by the United States Constitution. I've been asked to speak to you about Adel Hamad, detainee number 940 in Guantanamo. Mr. Hamad was abducted from his home nearly 5 years ago during a sweep of foreigners in Pakistan and sent to Guantanamo, where he is still being held without a court hearing, even though all the evidence gathered confirms he is an innocent man, a hard-working hospital administrator. Meanwhile, Adel Hamad's wife and 4 children in Sudan continue to suffer without him. She has written to President Bush asking for justice, but has received no reply. No one should be detained without a court hearing just on the word of a president, any president.
Two months have passed since our office released Guantanamo Unclassified, the story of Adel Hamad on YouTube. 75,000 people have watched that video, and newspapers and media outlets around the world have written stories about the Hamad case. I continue to be in regular contact with the Hamad family in Sudan.
ونحن كذلك يعني من سنة 92 بمعرفتنا بعادل ووضعه يعني حياته ومتوقعين إنه يكون يسجن لفترة 5 سنوات. الآن تمت 5 سنوات وما معروف. فنرجو إنه يأتي عادل حتى إنه يعني يجتمع أسرته.
Dear Mr. President, peace be with you, the mercy of God and His blessings. I am the wife of the Sudanese detainee, Adel Hassan Hamad. I am writing to you from the Sudan. My husband is a good and innocent man. He worked for charities that tried to help poor and sick people in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Our human condition is at its worst, and it is most difficult due to the absence of my husband, Adel, the only person who used to provide for our family. How tough life has been while my husband Adel is still detained and far away from me and from his daughters. It is true that we are alive, but without him our life has no taste, no color, and no smell to it. What can you say to very young children who have no water and no trees, no means of living, and the person who can clothe them has been placed in a dark pit? My youngest daughter, who is 5 years old, frequently asks me when her father will come home, but I cannot answer her. She forgot even what her father looks like because she has been deprived of seeing him for such a long time. Mr. President, please help me answer that question for her. Thank you.
Please join me in asking President Bush to answer Mrs. Hamad's question. When will Adel come home, Mr. President? When will his good name be cleared?
About 8 months later, the government sent Adel home. The first video was similar to the one with Martine, where William showed the people we interviewed in Afghanistan, people who confirmed where he worked, what he did, the people who knew that he was apolitical and was just following in his father's footsteps in the medical field. When I visited Sudan, and William and I were there, the little girl you just saw, somehow sensed that in some way I had some connection with her father. And the entire time that we were around the family, she was hanging onto my leg. And it was a very, very difficult, thing to deal with. While we were in Sudan, we met with the state minister, second in command in their foreign ministry. We met with the justice minister, the equivalent of our attorney general. We met with the entire Sudanese Human Rights Committee of their National Assembly and many other people. I am not allowed as a private citizen to engage in diplomacy. I was there to gather facts and offered them some facts. When they asked us, you know, what do you want us to do? I said, I'm a private citizen. And as a private citizen, I just on behalf of my client ask you to write to my government, as you just heard the wife wrote, and say, I went out on a little bit of a limb here, said, you know, I'm a Jew. And in my tradition, Moses, you know, let my people go. So why don't you Muslims here in Sudan just say to President Bush, let my people go? They had a little humor. They liked it. And they did. And shortly after that, the state minister came and negotiated about Darfur, which was a serious international problem at the time, and talked about Adel Hamad. And eventually, he was sent home. I won't show you the other video. We split the baby. You had some another little movie. If you want to watch the other one, you stay late after class. That's fine by me. So, not allowed. Fire away. Questions? Yes, ma'am. Microphones needed? All right. We have a microphone, Carter. Yeah. You'll be second. Yes, ma'am.
Jeanette Flaming, and in the Innocence Project, and you described all the levels that you can go through, I mean, cost becomes a really significant factor for people, especially if they give up on the system. And so that was one question. I mean, they would have to go through all those appeals, paying for them by themselves until they'd gone through it all to have you take the case. The other thing that it seems to me in sexual accusations, in that case, it's not you're innocent and proven guilty. It's guilty until proven innocent. I've understood that judges say that and other people in the criminal justice system. I'm sure that's not 100%, but it's some of those things that you talked about that were so important to us are really not available.
Well, with respect to your first question about cost, the state provides public defenders at no cost to people at the trial level, on appeal, and in the post-conviction process. So people do not need to dip into their own pockets. The state funding is inadequate. The dollar amounts paid the lawyers are about a tenth of what the market rate is if a person had money. With respect to the sex cases and the difficulty with the sex cases, they are incredibly difficult. It is incredibly difficult for people to believe that a seven-year-old could make up an accusation. And the unfortunate reality is there's a lot of abuse out there. The problem is not all people who are accused are guilty, and it's so difficult to sort out. Question up front here.
Yes, Karen Trekkie. I run into the same thing you had with Pete, even in the state and county and city government. And then I hear about your case with Pete, and I feel great frustration. My frustration turns to anger. I want to know how you deal with what I think you have is anger, too. I would imagine you do.
Yeah, sure, I get angry, but I can't live, riven by anger. I don't have an ulcer. Knock on wood, I'm 67. I don't take any medications. I love my wife. I love my son. I play tennis. I hike. I cross-country ski. And I remember being in sixth grade when my older sis played Meep in The Diary of Anne Frank at Pleasantville High School. And what an impression that made on me, and what an impression, in terms of, The Diary of Anne Frank, I still believe people are really good at heart. That phrase resonates with me. Whatever I have seen that is angering, that's wrong, that the government is this, the government is that, and government is evil, and the Russians killed my great-grandfather in a pogrom and all that stuff, I still believe that we're really all good and decent. And if you play to the good in people instead of the bad in people, we all come together. Adel Hassan Hamad, this black Muslim from Sudan, and I, this nice white Jewish kid from Brooklyn, New York, we found our common humanity while he was sitting in a jail cell in Guantanamo with a chain on his leg. We looked at each other as people. That keeps me going. That keeps me going. I could not live if I were full of anger. What's the point? Life is beautiful. That's me, my philosophy. What can I tell you? Sir.
Arthur Hill. I would be curious to know what your legal observations might be on the current brouhaha involving Hillary Clinton and her emails. I know you're pretty far removed from that, but still, as a lawyer, you must be following that with some interest, perhaps.
Well, of course, I have no facts, and no lawyer should ever offer any opinion without facts. However, what struck me in one of the media accounts was that the government has now classified some of the emails that were on her server in unclassified form. When I heard that, I had to laugh. because I reflect on what I said to you before, my yellow pad and Assistant Defender Pat Ehler's yellow pad, and the classification process, and how arbitrary it is about the declassification selectively in Muhammad's case. Well, you know, Hillary has this stuff. She says, apparently, it didn't have a stamp on it that said secret. How the heck is she supposed to know? And now, for what reason is that stuff coming out and someone making a decision to classify it today? I don't believe in conspiracy theories. However, you know, so I guess the other thing that I'd say is this little phone, which has more power than the computers that sent the men to the moon in 1969, I have Comcast, Outlook, and Gmail on it. I have my work, my private practice work, my Innocence Project work, my homework, my wife's name. Do we really all keep it all separate? And classified stuff, if it's marked classified, should be kept on a separate server. Well, again, I'm not there. But what I've read is that Hillary, in her home, had a setup with the State Department on which everyone knows she, as Secretary of State, is going to have some classified stuff. Well, if it's set up that way in an official way, for God's sake, what are we doing here focusing on that instead of other issues in the election? Next question. And that was an illegal opinion, and I certainly do not offer any political stuff. One last question, before you ask it. For whatever it's worth, so I pitched the Innocence Project. I also brought some of my books. I know some of you bought them the last time I spoke to you. If you're interested in reading more about Guantanamo and about Brandon Mayfield, and you want to have a signature in a book, come on up afterwards. Give me a $20 bill. I'll sell it to you below cost. Not below cost. All right. Last question. We're out of here. Well, at the back of the room. All right. I'll be up outside if anyone wants. One last question, 22 seconds.
This is Jim. I was wondering about the various people who have been exonerated for their crimes in this country. We had the one example of the gentleman overseas. Are they typically compensated for the time they spent in prison due to prosecutorial negligence or whatever?
They are not typically compensated. Some states, but not Oregon, have now passed exoneration compensation statutes. Great state of Texas will give you $80,000 a year. State of Washington gives you $50,000 a year. And Oregon, in the next full session, we intend to try to work to get an Oregon compensation statute passed. In terms of suing for misconduct, prosecutors and police have qualified immunity from lawsuit, which we actually want them to have because we don't want our police and prosecutors looking over their shoulder and making decisions about when to arrest or when not to arrest because they might be sued. I think it's a good policy to have qualified immunity. I think that it is a little too qualified, they have a little too much immunity, but we need that as a policy matter. I hear we need to get out of here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.